Good morning. Happy May Day. It is May Day, May 1st, celebrated around the world in various ways. First day of summer, places, dance around the maypole. Praise the May Fairy. All the little creatures of the forest are starting to move a little bit more. It's a labor movement day, May 1st. It still is. I didn't know, but that's true. Yeah, it's labor and established by the socialists and the communists and us. I mean, that's not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing. All right, sing along with me if you can. Oh, won't you stay? Stay a while with your own. Don't ever stray so far from your home. Is this old world is so cold? Don't care nothing about your soul. You share with your own ones. Don't rush away. Rush away from your own. Just one more day. One more day with your own. For the world is so cold, don't care nothing for your soul. You share with your own. There's a stranger, and he's standing at your door. Might be your best friend. Might be your brother, you may never know. Talk a while with my own. For the world is so cold, don't care nothing for your soul. You share with your own one. No, no, no. It's so interesting to be down on the floor with you. I I've told this story before, but the very first time we had a COP service up here, we were on the floor, and I think I was over there. I remember there were speakers on stands that I had set up, and Neil Donato was here, I think, and maybe there was a drummer, and maybe Rob Crozier playing bass. I can't remember, and I remember looking up at the stage. I was standing there, and I went like this, and there was a wall in front of the closed curtain, and I knew that on the stage there were dilapidated old secondhand theater seats and a 400-pound television, Jabba the Hutt television, and the kids would come up and watch VeggieTales and other videos. And I remember just going, what is going on here? And now look it. So it's ironic that I'm on the floor. But what's exciting about that irony is there is a plan that as part of the capital campaign, the architectural firm did make a plan for custom risers that would be right here. That this element of the plan just was not in the budget yet, but the risers are planned, and they will fit underneath the stage. The whole thing with stairs going up, so we can have two levels, an actual level here so that performers and preachers and others can be down closer, but also have another layer of man. I mean, you saw us on Easter where we were pretty crowded up there. I mean, it was great, but so this is a preview. That's what this is. And this whole, today is about growth, right? It's about, it's confirmation, right? Confirmation. So we picked a few songs that would address that. And this came to mind of a young person's grappling with some of the questions we're going to talk about today. Oh, my name, it ain't nothing. My age, it means less. The country I come from is called the Midwest. I was taught and brought up there, the laws to abide. And the land that I live in has gone on its side. Oh, the history books tell it. They tell it so well. The cavalry's charged. The Indians. The cavalry's charge, and the Indians die. Oh, the country was young, with God on its side. The Spanish American War had its day. And the Civil War too was soon laid away. And the names of the heroes I was made to memorize, with the guns in their hands and gone on. Oh, the First World War, boy, came and it went. The reason for fighting accepted with pride. For you don't count the day when God's on your side. The Second World War came to an end. We forgave the Germans, and then we were friends. Though they murdered 6 million in the ovens they fried, the Germans now too have gone on their side. I learned to hate the Russians all through my whole life. If another war comes, it's them we must fight. To hate them and fear them, to run and to hide, and accept it all bravely with God on our side. But now we've got weapons of chemical dust. If fire them we're forced to, then fire them we must. One push of the button and a shot worldwide. And you never ask questions when God's on your side. Though many dark hours I've been thinking about this, if Jesus Christ was betrayed by a kiss. But I can't think for you. You'll have to decide whether Judas Iscariot had gone on his side. So now as I'm leaving, I'm weary as hell. The confusion I'm feeling ain't no tongue can tell. The words fill my head, fall to the floor. That if God's on our side, He'll stop the next war.
Wow. Terry, that was a powerful song. It's very moving. I've got a question for you. How old is the person who wrote that?
Bob Dylan wrote that, and he was 20. Ish.
Sounds like he's 70.
Yeah.
I mean, wow.
Weird, isn't it? It's wild. It's like it's evidence for a soul. like an old,
yeah,
like knowledge that is there prior.
Oh, and boy, a song for today that was written so long ago, too. And, you know, every religion, every world religion, pretty much every world religion, thinks God's on their side.
I think that's the point of this.
And sometimes we have to figure out which God is on whose side. Wow. It's hard to talk after that. It really is. I don't have a joke to tell or anything else, I'll tell you. That is a very powerful piece you just sang for us. Especially today, I think. So, well, good morning. Welcome. We're glad that you're here. Very glad that you're here. A couple of quick announcements, and then I'm going to turn it over to a man who needs no introduction, but you're wanting to hear from this morning, I know. First announcement is today is Confirmation Sunday, so Darcy will say more about that. We confirmed one of the three confirmands on Thursday night, and we'll confirm two more of our confirmands at our 10 o'clock service today. Darcy's just back. Does she look wide awake? She's just back from a family camp. I'm sure she'll say a little more about that. And then next week is a very special Sunday because it's very good. I wanted to make sure you were all remembering. How come the men didn't say that? It was all the women who said Mother's Day. Men, take note. Take note. 2 weeks from today will be our last change of pace service on the 15th. Next Sunday is the last Sunday that we will have our choir part of our regular 10 o'clock service. And in 2 weeks, on the 15th, the Sunday where we have our last change of pace service before our summer break, following the 10 o'clock service, Mike Dabbs and maybe some others will be joining him. We'll be talking about the budget. Maybe, Rick, maybe you'll be joining him in that conversation. That will happen after the 10 o'clock service, I believe, in the sanctuary, and it will be live streamed, I believe, if you're not able to be there in person, which means that it will also be available following the meeting on YouTube. So a few things that are coming up. And without any further ado, I know the person you want to hear from today more than maybe almost any other, Brian Connolly, who's the chair of our God Share Committee, to give us kind of an update on how things are going with our God Share campaign this year. So, Brian, welcome.
Thank you, Bob. Well, as Darcy likes to say, good morning, church. God is on our side. At least I hope so during this campaign. 1 month ago, I stood here and I asked you to please fill out your God Share pledge card and get it in by the end of April. Now, the trustees charged us with a goal of $535,000. That's a lot of money. So we set sail on our good ship Mayflower with a mission to rejoice, renew, and reconnect. Today is May 1st, May Day, and I'm pleased to tell you that we have raised $310,000 to date. For all of those who have made your pledge, I say thank you, thank you, thank you. For everyone else, I tell you that our ship, the Mayflower, has become stuck on a reef out in the ocean and is in danger of sinking and not reaching our goal. Mayday! Mayday! What we need is a push to get us off the reef that we're stuck on, which naturally reminds me of a story. A man and his wife were lying in bed one night, 3 o'clock in the morning, pouring rain outside, and the doorbell rings. And the wife goes, George, get up. Somebody's at the door. He gets up, puts on his robe, slippers, walks down the stairs, turns on the porch light, opens the door, and there's a drunk standing there. He said, I need a push. He says, no way. It is 3 o'clock in the morning. It's pouring rain. No. And he closes the door, turns out the light, walks around, goes back up the stairs, takes his robe and slippers off, crawls into bed. And the wife says, well? He says, I was some drunk. Well, what did he want? He wanted a push. Well, what'd you say? Did you push him? No, it's pouring rain outside. Of course not. He's drunk. She said, well, by golly, you've sure got a short memory. You remember just a month ago, those two men helped us when our car broke down? They didn't have to stop, but they stopped and they helped us. Now you go help him. Oh, all right. So he gets back out of bed. This time he gets fully dressed, walks back downstairs, puts on an oil slicker and a big hat, turns the light on, steps outside. There's nobody there. Calls out. He says, are you still here? And off in the distance, he said, yes, I'm still here. He says, do you still need a push? He said, yeah, I need a push. Where are you? Over here on the swings. Well, what we need is a big push. We have to raise $225,000 if we're going to reach our goal. So if you haven't made your pledge, please do so as soon as possible. Every dollar counts and is needed, and with this inflation that's coming in, it's going to be even more important. In fact, the trustees are going to have to deal with this. You know, even if we make our goal at 535 with inflation, to make sure that we've got enough money to run our church for the next year. Now, on the other hand, if circumstances are such that you cannot pledge this year, I want you to know we understand. We do understand. But do this for us. Fill out your pledge card anyway and send it in just so that we know. For the rest of us, please give at least as much as you gave in the current year, and hopefully maybe you can increase it just a little bit. You can send it in by snail mail or online giving, or you can call Nancy Sauvey or Bob or Darcy or me, or you can use email, send smoke signals, get carrier pigeons, whatever you need, get your pledge in. If you don't, we're going to be calling you. You know it. So get your pledge in. Hopefully, if we all push our Mayflower ship off the reef, we'll reach this Ann Arbor port and we'll dock it right outside in our enormous parking lot. Then we can all gleefully dance around the Maypole. Rejoice, renew, recommit. Thank you.
Hi, church. We're going to do a little different of a sermon today. Terry and I are going to chat, but I did just return from family camp, and I want to tell you, we were outnumbered. Our ratio was 10 kids between the ages of 3 and 11 to 9 adults, and I felt like we were outnumbered far worse than that ratio, but it was a blast. They're still there today. I got up at really early and headed out. We were in Sawyer, Michigan, right on Lake Michigan, and we're really watching these kids grow in faith, and it was a perfect beginning to come here and talk about confirmation stuff. And Terry was saying, we're going to be on the floor today, and I said, cool, let's talk. Let's do, like, stool questions and whatnot. So we're going to answer a question, and then I'm going to invite you guys to talk about it at your tables. And if you want to join, if you're not sitting at a table and you want to join, great. If you don't, that's okay. We're Congregationalists. We don't make you do things. If you want to stay where you are, that's fine too. But I want to talk about faith questions that change you. And I think, Jared, you have them, I hope, because I don't have them in front of me. Perfect. So the first one, what's your earliest memory of religion?
It's very old. I was very old because we didn't have any church in our house. We went to a Presbyterian, but I think I can remember that. But my mom's like, no. Not because they didn't like it, but because it just didn't fit in with the timing of our lives. And so my earliest memories of like organized religion was actually like in high school, where because we sang sacred music all the time, and that's where a lot of my experience came from. It started. And honestly, my religion was like out in the woods when I was 5, 6, 4, and 3. Just like, I know it's cliche, and sometimes I've had Catholic Italian mothers tell me, "Oh, that's nice, but you got to do this. That's nice, but you got to do this." And I'm like, "Oh, well, I've made it this far, and I'm so." My experience with religion early on, as far as like modes of churches and stuff, is pretty slim, and I feel grateful for that, to tell you the truth, in my personal path, because the way that I can form, as an adult, ideas about religion are they're okay with me.
Even as a pastor, my earliest memory of religion is not a minister speaking some sermon and me being like, "Hey, Jesus, where have you been all my life?" It was escaping the sermon as a kid, where the kids run down and don't have to stay for the sermon and go to church school. I remember sprinting in my choir robe past the picture of like white Jesus with a six pack and the rainbow and all the little children around, and like sprinting past that to throw my choir robe in the closet and go do whatever the Sunday school was. And I don't remember the content of the lessons, but I remember feeling joyful and feeling like I was surrounded by a community of people that cared and good music. It started with music for me as well. So
I think my kids, you know, they grew up here, and their memories would be of that nature, just fun and free, can play. Mm-hmm. I remember Bob saying once early on, it's like, isn't it great when kids can just kind of run around a little bit and feel not so, you know, not constricted, and they would have that. They would have that feeling, I think.
Yeah. So you all, I'd like you to turn to each other and discuss this question amongst yourself, and when you seem like you're kind of done, we'll loft you one more.
Yeah. Jared's telling me something. What did they say? Good. All right. So it's so
interesting to hear, to eavesdrop on you. Just little words and images, parents and Christmas, because you know, there's so many things around your church experience at that time, for sure. I'm going to ask Darcy the next question, and it's about a time when you stopped believing that one thing about faith that you always did, that you always used to. So what changed it?
The song you sang, actually, for me, pointed out the thing that changed it for me was learning about the Holocaust, actually, as a high schooler, whenever you learn about that. And learning that Christian leaders who were hiding Jewish people and sometimes getting caught and sometimes getting arrested and killed for that could be persecuted for their belief. I grew up in this happy-go-lucky, everybody wants to be Christian, everybody loves Christians. Why would you ever persecute beliefs? Why would I ever have to be challenged on them? Like, I never imagined a world where I could be killed because of what I believed. And it made me question, do I believe it enough to risk my life? Do I believe in the values Christ taught enough to hide someone and know that that could be my demise as well? That that lesson of world history was really, really faith-changing to me. So maybe your answers don't have to be, maybe it was a life event for you, but I would love, I know this is a deeper question than the first one. The first one we just got you warmed up, but this is a deeper question, but I would love for you to take 5 minutes to discuss it at your tables. Okay, I'm going to draw us back together. Thank you for doing this activity. It's nice to connect with each other and talk about. I know it's not enough time. I know. Jared's keeping me honest with the time back there. And we're going to get a very truncated version of what the 10 a.m. is going to get. But I did want to briefly introduce you to these three confirmands that were that are getting confirmed today. And the verse that, one of the, my favorite verses in the scripture when we speak about confirmation is from Romans 12. Truthfully, Romans 12 is probably one of my favorite chapters of the whole Bible. But the one verse that I love from it says, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds." And that idea of transformation, and the Greek gets metamorphos, that's the word they use. These kids are being transformed. They're getting that question now. They're talking about what they had believed and what changed and what provoked the change and the processes. And I want to talk about, I want to point out each of them, and then I'll give you a short quote from one of their faith essays. One of our kids, his name is Lily Eggleston. She's the youngest of a couple kids that already went through the program. And one of my favorite classes, I gather them in this room and we talk about the Bible. And I want them to walk away with the idea that this is not this archaic book of instructions or inspirational quotes that would make good memes. It is messy and it is imperfect and at times it's contradictory. And I don't want them to think it's boring, and I don't want them to think it is out of reach. And so I flip through it, and I find the most disturbing stories of the Bible and tell them about it. wait for the shock factor. But with Lily, she was able to go beyond the shock factor and really get it why it's important. So she wrote this. She said, "The class in which we talked about the more messed up parts of the Bible was really important. She said, I think it's important to get a wider view of our religion because it's not all good and inspirational, and I think it's wise to understand that." This is a ninth grader who is already getting to the darker side of what religion can bring, the side that we heard from the song, the side that I think I've heard from snippets of conversations around the table, and already she's willing to dive into that, but do so without dismissing the sacredness of the book. Another student, Oliver, who is another youngest sibling of three whose older siblings went through it, the program, was talking about prayer and really struggling with what prayer means. He's no longer in a childlike state where you treat God as Santa Claus and pray for a list of things you want and hope if you're a good person they'll magically show up on your doorstep. He's beyond that, and he wrote this about prayer. He said, "I don't think if we pray, everything will just change. But if we pray, it will change our mindset. And maybe we'll start doing what we're failing to do." He said, "I don't think praying automatically changes something, but it will change what you think about and how you pray about it." It's a lot of wisdom for somebody that's 14, is it not? And one of the other things I loved about Oliver is he had that learning, and then he didn't just abandon it. He kept with that question. He has this new theory, was something that he didn't have when he began class, and he ended his essay with a question about there being any proof. He's like, "I wonder if they do studies that praying actually physically changes something in your life." And so he's still wondering, he's still exploring. That's what confirmation is all about, that transformation. The final student, we have Riley, who's mentored by Colleen there. All these students are standing with their mentors. Riley's an artist, and she was like, "Why do we have to write an essay? I'm an artist. Can I create something?" "Sure." I said, "You still got to get up in front of people and explain why you created it, but absolutely you can create something." So she took a look at our baptismal bowl in the sanctuary, and it doesn't quite fit in this little marble slab that it's supposed to set in, and Riley's a potter. And she said, "I would love to throw a new bowl for our church, one that represents me and the confirmation process." And so she did. It's currently in the fire at Skyline High School. And she loves marine biology. That's what she wants to do with her life. So she created like a wave pattern in it and loved the symbolism of the water and her own passion. And that is her gift to the church. And it amazes me that the hands of a young person on their faith journey are going to be the very thing that welcomes the youngest of our new FCC family members into the church. These are the three people we confirmed today. I think we're in good hands, don't you? So today, may you go from this place and know that we should keep questioning, even as adults, keep trying, keep praying, keep serving, keep volunteering, even if it is to be a mentor, because no matter what our age, we're called to keep transforming this world and to keep hoping and to keep shining light in places of darkness. And I believe that we have exactly the community to do just that, modeling it for our young people by doing it ourselves. So thanks be to God.